stop it. Stop the tape.
Here with Instant Replay in Beverly Hills, California, at none other than Murray the K's house. And Murray's filling us in on some very interesting rock information. We're talking now about how maybe the Beatles split up would have been prevented, especially since Murray was a very, very close friend of the group. And he's telling us a little bit into the insight of what really happened in those days, something that we've never really heard before. Murray, you were saying about Paul and his perfection.
Paul would do things like Brian Epstein told me once that he got a call in the middle of the night that Paul, they were ready to go to press with a song called Penny Lane. Oh. And Paul just felt that there was something missing that he wanted to add. And what he wanted to add didn't have one iota of difference in the hit potential of the record. But they stopped the pressing and they went in and he added that little thing. And that's the kind of perfectionist he was. But when the dichotomy started between Paul and John, one would bring in a song and the other one would bring in a song, and by that time they weren't writing together too much, uh-huh. That they agreed that both names would go on.
The McCartney-Lennon writing foundation was kind of coming apart.
Well, yeah, I mean, they were still being productive, but, for example, Day in the Life was two songs that they put together. John wrote one song, Paul wrote the other, and then Day in the Life is actually two songs put together into one.
There you go.
And but then when Alan Klein took over as manager, much to the objection of an Apple was formed. They started doing things which was not really their forte. I mean, they started going into businesses and producing film and things like that, particularly when they were on their acid trips.
Uh-huh.
So that what they were considering to be art was perhaps art to them, under the influence perhaps of acid and and whatever trip they were on. And
as a lot of people were back in the late 60s.
I mean, like the Magical Mystery Tour, I mean, it was took a long time to even get shown in the United States. It just bombed out in England. But things started falling apart. I mean, I think that Brian wouldn't have let it, sort of disintegrate into what it was. I mean, it was always a group effort. They always talk things over before they did anything. And one day they came into Klein's office and John and Paul were talking about, everybody was there. And then they talked about, well, this is the way Paul said he wants to write. And John says, I'm not happy with it. And Paul said, well, gee, I'm sorry, but that's the way I want to do it. And then John's words were, well, I guess that's it then. Hmm. And McCartney said, okay. Yeah. And
so John and Paul actually initiated the split.
Yeah.
There you go. Now, that's a rock first. I mean, as many stories as there are about the Beatles' breakup, you've heard it from the man who knows that it's just a matter of the two main writers not being able to see eye to eye there. And I've seen that in my own experience, Murray, with a lot of big groups, that you find one or two people emerge as the main writers. And then after a while, they just can't see eye to eye anymore. And
well, Paul, was writing. The story that, like Lennon had said, when they were going through that guru period, the
Maharishi?
Maharishi Yogi. He said it was nice being up there in the foothills of the Himalayas, and it's a nice resort, it's a camp, he said, and the reason that Maureen left first was nothing to do with Ringo, it's just the fact that she couldn't stand the flies, and he said, but he found that he was writing just the absolute opposite songs. He said he wrote I'm So Tired, which was my own feelings. And he said he also wrote up there in the White Album, Your Blues.
Oh, yeah.
Which he described as another miserable song, which was really my own blues. And he was writing just the absolute opposite songs of where he should be. And he came to the bell of reality ringing for him that, God is a concept. And he says, I don't believe in gurus. I don't believe in Beatles. If you remember the lyric of that song.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And that's where He came to his own reality of what he wanted. And when you make that amount of money and you have that amount of pressure and you know for the rest of your life if you never write again, you're going to be getting a couple of million dollars a year just from your royalties if you never did another thing.
Right.
You start to get into things that you're interested in and you go on to the next plane. I don't think the Beatles undying. No, I know unless some sort of catastrophic event happened, there isn't a chance in the world they'll ever get back together again. I hope they don't.
Do you still hear from them from time to time?
I've been speaking to Ringo a lot, but not too much since his house burnt. He's really bummed out on that. I've spoken to George. George goes to India a great deal. He's into that. I think it was a shame about his last tour. Again, it's not managing the, you know, having the right people around you.
Right.
Too many yes people. John is just doing nothing, but as long as he's happy, I mean, who's to say that he should do anything other than what makes him happy? And they really have no obligation to do any of this stuff. They haven't. The people made them what they are, and it's their prerogative to say later, which they've done. I mean, there's no way that they could get together and play. I mean, you realize no one ever really heard them in concert because of that cacophony of screaming gals and the bad acoustics in the large halls. You never even heard them on the Sullivan Show, right? Because they had the mics turned up on John's harmony instead of Paul's lead.
You were very instrumental in bringing the Beatles over from England to America. Did you ever think then, when you were bringing them over, that they would be as big and affect the whole world and people's lifestyles like they did?
Oh, no. Nobody could really. You can't imagine anything like that. I think that certainly when they came over, She Loves You and I Want to Hold Your Hand are certainly not what you call your basic classics, you know, compared to where they went musically after that. But they brought over a whole new attitude, which was filled a void with Kennedy's death because we had a style in this country. And for the younger people, they came over with a whole new concept. Not so much their music as much as their attitude. I mean, they were the first group ever to put the press on. I mean, really, they were sensational. And their senses of humor were great, and they were just what the country needed. And that's what caught my attention more than their music at first, was their attitude and how they affected. And I think that people will say, well, yeah, they sold more guitars, and they the American groups were not really self-contained in those days. I mean, the Fox, that's why I had a 16-piece band, you know, maybe they'd come along with a rhythm section of their own, but that was it. There were no self-contained groups until the Beatles came along, and then everybody was a self-contained group. The Four Seasons, believe it or not, when they played clubs, when they hit it with Sherry Sherry, they were a cocktail lounge club. They came on the stage of the Fox for one show. They never did it again, coming out, playing their instruments. One of them played an accordion.
Oh.
I couldn't believe it, you know. So the Fox turned into be a school, you know, for a lot of people. Dion started there. I mean, she really never knew how to walk on stage before. She filled in when Shirley of the Shirelles was getting morning sickness. She was pregnant. She filled in there. And, of course, I go back to my first protege, Bobby Darin, and then then Mathis, and then Dion, and then Stevie Wonder, and then the Beatles. And then as a favor, the Beatles have brought the Rolling Stones over. The thing I'm proudest about the Stones was I brought them over when they didn't have a hit. They had a thing called Not Fade Away, and they were doing imitations of Buddy Holly and Bo Diddley and Chuck Berry, and I gave them a song, which turned out to be their very first hit, the first time they went to number one in England, first time they made the top three on the charts in the United States. It was a little thing that Bobby Womack wrote called It's All Over Now, and then they started writing their own stuff and writing the kind of material. I mean, I thought, like, when they hit I Can't Get No Satisfaction, if you talk about reaching the audience of saying everything that the kids wanted, felt, that song was it. I mean, that was really great. And they were off and running there. But it was fun. It was fun picking out, you know, people like The Who and deciding that, you know, they never heard of Eric Clapton, you know, mm-hmm. the United States. So when I brought over the Cream, it was unbelievable in the sense that if I would have put the Who, the Cream, and Jimi Hendrix on the same show, along with Wilson Pickett and Smokey Robinson and the Miracles, I mean, or any of the shows I had now, I could never afford it. So things have changed a great deal. And they always change for the better, for the groups, I think. Before, the producers would make a lot of money. I mean, I made a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
But I also launched a lot of stars and created an avenue for them to sell their wares, to learn a little bit about the business, to take rock and roll and put it into reviews as opposed to just concerts. And that period passed when I perhaps went into FM, and then I started to get into the Buffy St. Marie's and the Phil Oakes's and the Dillons and the Simon and Garfunkel's, and I changed my shows a little bit. I never really should have. I was trying to always stay ahead, and I got to where the Beatles were, and I decided, hell, the hell with it, you know. Once you get to the top, there's no other place to go but down, and the idea, it was fun, because getting to the top, believe it or not, was not that easy for me. Once I had the time spot, and I had the stage, and I built it, and it was successful. If you have it, and what people want, they're going to come, and you just continue to do what you're doing. It's sustaining it. And so after 9 years of sustaining it with my shows, 10 years really, I decided to try something else. Moved out of New York and took a dollar a year job doing something I felt was worthwhile. And then came back to New York, went on the air, did another kind of concept, started a dance called The Hustle and some discos in 73, 74. Came out, got involved with Beatlemania, and now I'm going back on the air, and I'm going to do my shows again, all from out here, with very big production stuff, and sold my movie. Now they're doing another thing on my life story, which we're turning into a thing called The Rock Chronicles.
You've had so many movies made about your life story. How does it feel when you see them all back? Are any of them really valid? Do any of them really come close to the real Murray the K?
I don't know. I'm trying to figure out who he is. You know, I lost him along the way a little bit. I'm having fun though, because now I can use. I never knew who the hell Murray Kaufman was when I became Murray the K. I mean, it got to a point of being on the air every day for as long as I was, doing my stage shows, being a very visual person because you're doing stage. I had Murray the K's World. I had the television and the